I'm particularly thrilled to be here with the frontline defenders, and I'm particularly thrilled to do so with the wonderful Andrew Anderson, indeed, who's a fantastic colleague. The international community owes a great deal to Frontline, an enormous debt of gratitude for their shining example. And the example that Frontline Defenders sets by shining this bright and broadcast light on those who truly are on the front line. I feel like I'm in some sort of really weird echo chamber. Are you getting a... It is a bit odd, isn't it? I almost don't need the microphone. But this will drive you nuts. I mean, my voice is going to drive you nuts, and now you're going to get... Needs maybe to be turned down. I think the very remarkable way that Frontline Defenders has made of solidarity and accompaniment such a practical and yet powerful tool to celebrate, affirm, acknowledge. The courage of people who, on the front lines of human rights defence, are often imperiled rather than upheld. I think the way Frontline Defenders has done that actually elevates us all. And it's a very, very precious role that the vision and the intention and the fact of the organisation has played, and certainly the international community, Andrew, owes you and through you, your colleagues, an enormous debt of gratitude for that example. And in fact, for the solidarity you've shown back to the mandates of human rights and for human rights defenders. I wanted to speak about why that intimate relationship to the act of human rights defence, the claim of human rights defence, and the exercise of human rights as verbs, not nouns, just matters so much. You know, beyond the evident existential crises that rooted in rights betrayed, daily disgrace, daily grace, the landing pages and front pages of our various media sources, beyond that existential crisis, there's something very special about this year, because it marks the 70th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was a turning point in textual, words-based accounts of what it means indeed to be human one unto the other. It's important to recall that it was conceived in Holocaust, the child of two world wars. But it emerged from centuries of longing, unfulfilled. Longing of cultures diverse, temporarily, by temporal nature and by geography, and diverse down the ages. It reflected a longing for some innate sense that we all have. That we must be treated fairly and justly. That declaration of 48, it wasn't born in either prosperity or privilege, but rather it arose amidst the rubble and the ruin of a reckless, ruthless rancor. And out of that horror, steeped deep in the very worst that human beings can manage to do each other, it encapsulates the very essence of what can be said to be a legitimate relationship between you and I, on the one hand, as equals, and on the other hand, between us and the power, ultimately of the state. In other words, it's a textual account of how to legitimately hold power and relatively powerlessness together in the form of community. Politicized fictions, I should say,
would wish us to believe otherwise, but that declaration was not the impost of the white, worried and well. It wasn't the impost of the West in a form of neo-colonialism. In reality, there were 81 meetings and 168 resolutions debated over more than 12 months by people all over the world. The West were amongst the most reluctant to see a Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Much of the content for the idea that born we all are equal in dignity and rights came from the newly independent decolonized states. Latin America was the strongest voice for economic, social, cultural rights. The Soviet Union insisted on clauses pertaining to race discrimination. Eleanor Roosevelt, the US chair, had very little to do with the actual drafting of the words. India and Pakistan argued persuasively for this: equal pay, equal distribution of property, equal application of marriage laws, and specifically against child marriage. And it was a member of India's Constituent Assembly at the time, a woman called Hansa Mehta, who was responsible for including as Article 1 that statement. That instead of, as it was planned to read, all men being born equal, it should read indeed as it does, all humans are born free and equal in dignity and rights. The Chilean drafter of the Universal Declaration said this truly significant historic event in which a consensus emerged about the supreme value of the human person. Not the supreme value of rights, not the supreme authority of the state, the supreme value of the human person who has rights and who is entitled to claim from the state the duties that the state should fulfill to uphold those rights. The supreme value of the human person, including the right to fully develop one's own personality. It doesn't get much more intimate than that. That you be unique, that you be individual, and that you be regarded as a priori state of being fundamentally equal. Born, we all are, equal in dignity and rights. My point is that even in the human rights movement, most certainly by governments, and upheld time and time again in courts, the declaration has been reduced to a contest about the state as duty bearer and the individual as rights holder, or the holder of rights. Now, they are two essential elements of the modern human rights story. But there's a third piece here that has been forgotten by many, abused by a number, and in each instance always driven grave and toxic consequences for those who are on the wrong end of the relationship with power. Yes, the state's duty to our rights, and indeed my rights, and the way they interact with yours, that's the relational account of the Declaration. That's the relationship the Declaration seeks to codify. And in that sense, remarkably, 70 years old this year, it is a declaration of our interdependence. It's an acknowledgement that we are inextricably linked as holders of rights and as claimants on the state. But it asserts this other core concept, the principle, the idea that at the heart of the project, yes as means, but most importantly as ends, is this pre-existing person. You know, I remember when working in a large hospital that medical staff would complain about the interference with their enjoyment of medical practice that the patients created. I recall teachers complaining that they could enjoy education so much more except for the students. There are priests who resent the parishioner. Governments, as Bertolt Brecht once said, who find it simpler to dissolve the people and elect another. I want to suggest that there has been many a lawyer and too many a human rights boffin who has thought more about the rights and less about the human, and has sought through technocracy of treaty, convention, declaration, general comment here, decision there, jurisprudence at the international, national, regional, local, yes, all important. But in seeking that technocracy for rights, has frequently lost sight of the main game. And in qualification of that ultimate purpose, I think we should be very clear. There's no culture and there's no religion. There is no geography. There's no east or west. There's no north or south. There's only the humane and the inhumane. It's to our shame as a human rights movement that under legacy of some Cold War fixation on the toxic consequences of state power abused, something like the totalitarian state's governance, that we have lost touch with what ultimately even John McCain recently referred to as the quarrelsome, vociferous souls whose duty governance carries to ensure that there is not unfair and undue interference with. The person. Friends, the problem is the idea of the person. Not only is it rendered far too often invisible, not only is it far too often fragmented into bits and pieces, dismembered by law and policy, by mandate in the human rights system, so that it is no longer remembered. What's deeply, deeply troubling is the very idea of who qualifies as a person over time, throughout history, and even today, has been sometimes ruthlessly contested. We recognise readily enough, I think, that the idea of universal rights is intended to set up boundaries over which power cannot with legitimation step. But inside those same lines, the idea, the intent, was to create an open space, a terrain, in which could flourish without interference physical and mental integrity, and in that all our diversity, all our uniqueness, all our difference, our desire, our willfulness, our clamour, checkpoint Charlie at the outer borders of that space, is this idea that we're all entitled to it. An unassailable premise because there is no conscionable alternative to it, that born we all are equal in dignity and rights. And yet, somehow, throughout history, even today, why is it the case that this very stable proposition for which there is no legitimate alternative should be so contested? So unstable. To be prosecuted challenged and fought over time and time again. You know, the US, just after the abolition of slavery, struck the three-fifths compromise, which determined that for political and economic purposes, only three out of every five slaves would be deemed persons. Canada, at the beginning of last century, had to overturn the Persons Act in order to recognise women as people. In my country, up until, you know, the mid-60s, under certain law, typologies of categorisation put Aboriginal people, the first peoples of Australia, in the same lists as flora and fauna. This to me suggests omnipresent in the human effort at social arrangement, there are at least two critical themes. One very familiar to human rights defenders, the theme of what shall the authority, the organising power, the state be entitled to do with its coercive authority, a power to deprive liberty, a power to impose fines, a power even to extinguish life. What are the thresholds at which the state may exercise that power? That's a very familiar space occupied by human rights discourse and indeed by much of the experts on the rule of law. But there's a second, and I would just say, look, a far less explored, understood and challenged agenda here, or even though it's as ubiquitous in life, and that is the extent to which there is and indeed should be a large, free and open space pre-existing the state, pre-existing the creation of law, unstructured, unmediated, that is ourselves as people, simply by virtue of being human. It's a critical question because the state's coercive power amidst its other powers plays an absolutely critical, censorious role in defining who shall be qualified as a person. We are constantly being required to fit a template of an idea of a human being. The citizen as compared to the stateless, the resident as compared to the migrant, the worker as compared to the slave, the lawyer as compared to the child, the parliamentarian as compared to the prostitute. Criminal law, amongst the most powerful of the legitimate manifestations of the state, is playing a key role in this ascription of equal value as a human being. Indeed, from a human rights standpoint, we need that power. We need the power of law to uphold and protect our rights. It's the essence of justiciability. It's essential for accountability. And much effort has gone into codifying the rule of law as compared to rule merely by law. But it is also the case that law, which should be shield when it comes to certain ideas of person, has become sword. And it is this shield-sword contradiction that we enable when we fail to hold the ground about the basic essence of who and what is a human being. There is violence written into the making of these decisions. And in that violence, there is the production and the reproduction of majorities and minorities. Herein lies the source and the construction of racism, of sexism, of homophobia, the rejection of the body disabled, the rejection of the body by colour, the rejection of the person by genitalia. And in this, the instruments of law have been manipulated in many, many jurisdictions the world over into a sword against rights, when the intention was that it be shield. Look, maybe it doesn't matter so much in the abstract, but in practice there have been such grave consequences from this. Historically, the state, the law, traditional authorities, and I must admit, by its omissions, even human rights orthodoxy too, have conspired in this deprivation of personhood. Nowhere is this clearer than with regards, I would argue, it is in respect of women. For Confucius said, 100 women are not worth a single testicle. I'm just trying to think of the scales that would... The pith of Napoleon Bonaparte's view was this, that women were nothing more than machines for producing children. In equal tweetable form, celebrated author Norman Mailer mused publicly that, gosh, a little bit of rape, it's good for a man's soul. His view is very much appreciated by Indian politician Botsa Satyan Arana, who opined, look, just because India has achieved freedom at midnight doesn't mean women can go out in the dark. That rape victim should have thought twice before catching the bus in the evening. The incident, yes, it was really condemnable, but she should also have behaved. He's not alone, because joined to that spirit of consensus comes Jacob Zuma, Honourable President of South Africa, who found himself under burden of state leadership, needful to say this, I wouldn't want to stay with daughters who are not getting married, because that in itself is a problem for society. Having kids is important to a woman because they actually give extra training to a woman. She learns to be a mother. Echoed by his contemporaries, reflecting on the risks and the threats and the need for particular confinement of the body feminine, comes the Honourable G. Gordon Liddy, who expressed it in these terms. Let's hope that the key conferences aren't held, meaning legal conferences, aren't held when Judge Sonia Sotomayor is menstruating. Or just because she's going to menstruate, that would be really bad, because Lord knows what would happen if a judge were to menstruate. I'm frankly quite puzzled by those who dispute that there are such things as universal values, or who think that concern for gender equality is somehow singularly an enlightenment project or somehow a monopoly of modernity. Because, you know, the contest for gender-based and gender-defined superiority is universal. The enthusiasm for gender inequality is found in every corner on the earth. And it would not be so evident in history or today, think about it, had not the opposing idea of gender equality also been present throughout. Confucius would not have felt needful to compare the metric of the testicle to that of the woman had there not been a proposition that somehow a woman was valuable. There's no legislation anywhere in any parliament in the world commanding the sun to rise. There's no legislation that says, we, the parliament of this good state, do declare the moon shall have a cycle. No parliament thinks, really, it's their business to instruct the sun to rise, sort of understanding that if it instructed the sun not to rise, it wouldn't make one bit of difference. What on earth are parliaments doing, and indeed power doing, to imagine it has a place in deciding some body intimate are more human than others? And why has it done that down the ages? And I would say the answer is quite simple, because down the ages there has always been a struggle for equality. It is no more an invention of modernity than the human rights values are Western, because even the West can't uphold the values of human rights. Somehow, the female body has been converted into something less than human, perennially. It's been made, in fact, a battleground. Just think about the image on the Mediterranean beach of armed police guards bending over Muslim women with guns, requiring them to remove their outer garments. How can it be that the callous, cowardly, criminal violence that was perpetrated against people in Paris and Nice so rapidly and immediately became about the body of the woman? What preposterous perversion penetrated the political... I'm running out of peas. The state's obsession with this intimate feminine form is politically very uneven. It singles out certain female bodies, and it does it by race, by socioeconomic status, does it by disability with regards to Indigenous women. The fault lines of determining the degree to which the feminine body intimate should be free are the same fault lines that describe the worst of bigotry, the most inhumane of discrimination. And that unhealthy obsession with the containment of the feminine form has alongside it shameful, shame-ridden ideas of the body sexual and the body desirous. And it has opened the door to ill-informed and illegitimate interference in our most intimate decisions, including for us as lawful adults, whether and with whom we choose to have sex, whether and with whom we choose to have children, how to form and dissolve a marriage. Antithetical, actually, to human rights standards, this notion of women as somehow more like property, of heteronormativity as a norm, of heterosexuality as perverse, these are tenaciously reinforced by a remarkable appetite by those who seek superiority as non-women, a remarkable appetite for ignoring fact, for ignoring the facts that abortion rates do not decrease with restrictive legislation. Only safety of abortion does. Ignoring the facts that criminal laws on HIV transmission doesn't stop the spread of HIV, it only fuels it. Pretending that the human rights disaster of the so-called war on drugs, with its undue interference in the body intimate, pretending that it's done other than flatly failed to reduce the extent of drug trafficking and drug use, and instead has resulted in a massive, unsustainable rate of incarceration of the poor. It's not the narcotic-using head of state requiring it for easing the aches and pains of old age who is caught up in the war on drugs. It is the poor It is those with the least resources to protect themselves, those with the greatest need for essential services who are most deprived. We know that subjecting consensual adults to prohibition does not work, and instead makes things worse. We know that criminalizing intimate, consensual activity doesn't stop it, it drives it underground. And we know that criminal law specifically has more often in these terms been an instrument of bigotry and of discrimination against LGBTIQ people, people living with AIDS, sex workers. And we know that this is counter to every intent and principle, hope and aspiration that the UDHR promised us. Friends, you know, upholding rights doesn't require approval of conduct. You don't have to like me to respect my rights. I don't have to be like you to uphold your rights. We don't have to agree with each other to defend each other's rights. Rights are not a beauty parade or a reward system. They're not some kind of nepotistic prize for good behaviour. Rights are for the best and for the worst of us. They're simply that which cannot with legitimation be taken away from us. And against attack, this must be defended. In any and all contexts, we must simply insist that the law delivers comprehensively the space we all require if indeed we are a priori to be human and to occupy that space equally. And in this, again, masculinity and femininity are not the primordial states. Humaninity is. Why am I banging on about this? Well, I reckon it'd be important at any time. But you know, given what is happening in the world, this is no longer just important. It's now dramatically urgent. There is alive today more young people than the world has ever, ever seen before. By sheer scale alone, age is going to join gender and ethnicity this century as the key defining identity. It is the greatest by scale and the fastest by onset demographic transition in all of human history. It's the outcome of incredible development successes, reduction in maternal mortality, reduction in infant mortality, improvements in care for children under five. But on the other side of it, now there is alive today more young people than ever seen before. And indeed, if we took only the world's populations of adolescents and made of them an ethnicity, the equivalent of a country, it would be the size of India, the world's second largest country. Why does that matter? You know, in human development terms, there are two key journeys that we take from in the pathway from childhood through adolescence to adulthood. One is a learning journey, an education journey. You know, and it's partly the fact of young people being so populous today that it's become almost fashionable to talk about education first. But in the dual-laned highway of human development, there's a second lane for which we do not invest in institutions. We don't create policy and pursue professional discipline in the same way as we do for education. And that second lane is the pathway we all take from childhood through adolescence into adulthood, where we become ourselves. It's in those years, with the onset of puberty, that we become desirous, gendered, sexual, intimate. What do we offer that second element of the journey from adolescence to adulthood? Shame, stigma, deprivation of essential services. We become head of a government, and on our second day in office, we enact a legislation to reintroduce a prohibition on sexual and reproductive health and rights, in order that the body intimate be made once again a battleground for politics, for ideologies, for personal preferences. Politicized fictionalization through shame and stigma of what the human person is entitled to. The consequences for young people are dire. Do you know there was only one group for whom deaths by HIV and AIDS increased over the life of the Millennium Development Goals? It was the adolescent. For every other age group, deaths from HIV and AIDS decreased 30, 40, 50%. For the adolescent, it went up over 50%. Why? Deprived of basic access to comprehensive sexuality education. Old enough to be pregnant, but too young to have contraceptives. Old enough to be a parent, but too young to go to a doctor for advice on your pregnancy. Old enough to catch a sexually transmitted infection, but too young to have the information to know how to avoid it. Old enough to be married, too young to vote. What on earth are we thinking? Is it adult amnesia? Have we forgotten so comprehensively what it felt like over the course of that journey into adulthood? Do you not remember the toxic entrapment of shame and ignorance, of fear and yet emerging desire? How is it that we should abandon the child at puberty, when puberty, with its onset, has come down even further? So perverse is our relationship to this body, this emerging, maturing body. Do you know that we don't collect any data on sexual and reproductive health under the age of 15 and none over the age of 49? Now, I just want to make the point for the average onset today of puberty is around 10 for girls. It's reduced dramatically. So between 10 and 15, because we do not want to accept the body intimate of that child emerging into adulthood, we collect no data. What's very interesting is we also don't collect any data over 49. So look, if you're approaching 49, I'm just saying, look, get on with it, because apparently, once you're 50, that's it. Of course, somehow mysteriously, you know, the one age group for whom sexually transmitted infections is on the increase, it's the over 50. An extraordinary loyalty to defiance of fact has marked and impeded and prevented the ascription of the full panoply of rights matched to needs in the human development pathway. And this is not just wrong, it is now tragic. You know, the median age of conflict today, you know, the median age of South Sudan, anybody? 17. The median age of Central Africa Republic? 17. The median age of Yemen? 18. The median age of Niger, 15. The median age of Uganda? 15. The median age of Germany? 47. The median age of parliamentarians? 53. The median age of non-tech billionaires? 71. A quarter of Europe's billionaires are aged over 80. Think about what it means. Young people today, 90% of them are living in the world's poorest countries. 90%. 90%. Youth is poor, poor, poor. It's caught up in conflict. It is most exposed to disaster. It's living with the least access to the rights to which we are all born. And on top of it, we invest next to nothing in that which would enable those young people not only to emerge educated and available to the labour force and hence the demographic dividend about which so many people speak, but critically we deny them that which would enable them to emerge in dignity and rights, intimately, sexually, desirously, without violence, without shame, without imbibing the self-made disgust that seems to drive so much of our efforts to deprive recognition of sexual and reproductive health and rights. This now is no longer just the bleatings of old white feminists with a bad attitude to authority, although there is a bit of that. This is now one of the most strategic challenges the world has today. Age-based inequality steeped in a huge disparity of wealth with absolutely no bridges between the privilege of old age and the disempowerment of the young and the very young. We simply cannot afford to indulge our comfort zones any longer. It's time that adults grew up. The body intimate, the body upheld so that emerges into adulthood, talented, with dignity, without injury, not lost to forced and early marriage, not damaged by sexual and gender-based violence, not locked out of talent, as indeed in Tanzania is now the case by pregnancy. The minute a girl is pregnant, she's forced out of school. And while we're at it, I just want to notice that girls don't fall pregnant. We fall down the stairs. You don't lose your virginity. Oh, where did I put it? You lose your keys. There is always someone else involved. And without exception, for the adolescent girl, it is always somebody who has more power than she. An extraordinary philosopher, Hannah Arendt, 70 years ago, speaking in the same era that birthed to us the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, she worried terribly. She was someone who had stared the brutality of the Holocaust right in the eyes. And, you know, she came out of that exposure to deep totalitarianism with a conviction for rights, but a fear of the nation state and the fact that we can't trust the nation state was very much on her mind. And so she said this. She said, look, it's a question of who has a right to rights. And the only way we can secure our right to rights is to be citizen first and person second. I personally would like to think that were she here today, we could persuade her to the contrary. To be person first. Because rights are for all of us, to the exclusion of none of us, in the interests of each of us. A person born equal in dignity and rights. An intimate, desirous, vociferous, clamorous, willful, messy person whom the state should let alone except for purposes of protecting from harm. And indeed, from the harm that I might do to you. You know, incidentally, today is the International Day against homophobia, transphobia and biphobia. It's a recognition, the power, the importance, the dignity, the centrality of the body intimate and of the essence of human rights for all. Thank you very much.